there's a little bit longer. It's fun.
Please be respectful of those that are speaking. Please don't shout out. And if asked, we will have security here if needed. I know this is a crowded room. There are seats over here on the side if you want seats still. I'm going to turn the meeting over to the applicant and their professionals. When they are finished with their presentation, we're actually going to break into different stations for you to ask specific questions about scenarios and information. There'll be a transportation spot, environmental spot, the applicant. So we will disperse to go to those different locations to ask your questions at that time. I'm going to turn it over to the applicant for their presentation. Thank you for being here this evening.
First of all, can I be heard?
No.
Is that on, Bill?
Should be. This one wasn't working. Now can I be heard?
No.
Bill, try this one.
Speak louder.
Hold it right down there.
Now can I be heard? Now can I be heard?
Yes.
Okay. That's good. I was a little bit unnerved because I didn't get the memo on the dress code. It's more unnerving because I'm a graduate of Georgia Tech. And it feels like I'm sitting in the middle between the hedges. Of course, being between the hedges last Thanksgiving was not too bad a deal. My name is Bill Prost, and I am a part of the application, the applicant. I'm also a land developer. A number of people here from Martin's Land. How many of you all knew or heard of Dean Stratton? Great. Dean was one of my good friends. He was a colleague and he was a competitor. Dean was a land developer. Dean did not build houses. Dean developed lots and then sold. Yes, he did. He sold all of his property. And he sold it to builders who then built houses. Dean and I are similar. He was older than I was, or I am. He was in the Second World War. I just grew up during it. But he developed your community into one of the most spectacular areas in Metro Atlanta. He had kind things to say about me, because about the time he launched Martin's Landing, I was launching my Smoke Rise development, and while we've kind of tracked each other over the years. Smoke Rise has 1,500 acres and about 5,000 residents. A lot of the integral things in the community, maybe that you all don't have. I got four churches, school, 18 hole golf course, industrial park, and so forth. So I have a good deal of experience in land development. And I admire those of us that were in the business before it started to be called horizontal and vertical. We called it developers and builders. Now it's horizontal and vertical. But I knew Dean well, and we did the same thing. We acquired the land. We had engineers, designers design the subdivision development. We had contractors bid on the work to be done on the development. We put in all the infrastructure. We prepared the site for houses, and then we sold. Now, Dean sold all of his lots to builders. I developed 25,000 lots, and I sold about half of those lots to individuals, because I discovered that the individuals were very anxious to have a selection in their site. And I had a tagline that I used for years, and it was, even a diamond needs the proper setting. Well, we've got ourselves a diamond here that got me out of semi-retirement to take another bite at the apple and to add this to my portfolio of developments. Because the 106 acres that we're going to be discussing is one of the most exciting, challenging, and spectacular pieces of property that I've seen in my 55 years. Exciting beyond description. You're going to hear tonight from our engineer, Ken Wood. you're going to hear from our architect, and you're going to hear from our traffic analyst on the professional approaches that we have taken in putting together this project that we think is going to add far more than detract. Everybody has a good, different opinion. That is our opinion. And so I'm going to carry you just a moment through some things that we hadn't talked about before. And one of them is the timeline. Let's say that we are zoned in 2015, then all of 2016 and a part of 2017 is going to be spent on the engineering design for the entire property. It leads to what we know in the business as a land disturbance permit. And it is highly regulated. And it involves people from all over, not just Roswell, but we're talking about the State Environmental Protection Division. We're talking about the Corps of Engineers. We're talking about stream buffer protection. We're talking about all the things that are necessary to put together a set of plans. And I have a pretty good idea of how long it's going to take. We're in the process of spending 14 months getting 100 lot developments approved in another jurisdiction. So when I talk about the scope of this, I think it's going to go beyond the middle of 2017. Let's say we got lucky, then. Next, we're going to have to be sure that everything passes muster from the various departments before we embark on the actual development of the community. Land development. No building. Land development. The first thing that's going to be required actually sets where we start this development. People have been asking, where's the first phase? Well, the first phase is where the lake is, where the water is, and where the state mandates that we shall not do anything until we have completely protected the environment. So we know what the code requirements are and the length of time. We will be involved in selecting contractors to perform the work of the land development. We will have to give notification to some of the apartment owners about their need to be relocated. And the relocation of those residents is our responsibility. And then we're going to embark on what's known as erosion control. When I started in this business back in the 1950s, the most expensive thing to deal with on development was paving. Right now, the most expensive thing to deal with is erosion control and protection. We'll put up miles of silt fence. I said silt fence. It sounds like silk fence, but candidly, it costs more than silk fence. It's expensive, very expensive. We're talking about millions. Just to prepare the site for the environmental inspector to come on board and say, guess what, you're good to go. So, question, what is going to be the first area developed? Answer, the village. We are the village of Riverwalk. That's where we will be developing. Makes good marketing sense, makes good balance sense. You have residential, commercial, and you have the environment, and the thing that I want to talk about most is the lake and the handling of the water. But that's what makes the most sense. So that's where we will start. The construction of the project will span over many, many years, but the land development has to track what's necessary to balance the dirt and to move dirt around so that we get the layout and the renderings that you see that are placed on this board. That's my job. That's what I've been doing for 56 years. Yes? I'm 83 years old, and I want to get this done before I check out, because I believe in this. I believe in the property. I've walked the property. I've walked it up and down and crisscross. I know where and what we're going to do with this lake. You'll see in the renderings that are coming up. We're going to cross over it. We're going to make it far more attractive. But the exciting thing to me, because I'm a registered professional engineer, I'm a registered landscape architect, I'm a registered land surveyor, and this is not my first rodeo. I had an opportunity in this to create surface water drainage that is different from, pick it up in a pipe, carry it into a hunk of concrete, and then call that beautiful, putting a fence around it. That is no way to treat the land and the environment that God has given us. It don't make any sense to me. It never has. So we're going to do it with channels. We're going to do it with a controlled mechanism so that it gets down to where it belongs in the lower reaches, and it does it with beauty and functionality. And we're going to move it through 50% open spaces, environmentally protected. That's what the intent is. Are we going to sell the property? Yep. Ultimately, everybody in this room lives in a house, and I don't think that any of you had the intention of collecting it. You sell based on needs, you keep based on needs. One thing we definitely are going to sell, and we're going to sell it early on, and that is Swift School. That will be the first thing that will be developed, because Swift School sits on a tract that is on the other side of Old Alabama, so it's not impacted by the amount of environmental constraints that we have in what I call the spine. So that's the answer. Swift is going to be here. They are under contract. We are very excited. You have a beautiful place here. You live in a fine community, and this is a change. We understand that. I'm not a stranger to this kind of a presentation and this kind of a difference of opinion. What we ask of you is to look at what we propose, to look at how we propose to do it, and then make some determinations. We believe in it very strongly. Thank you. Even in red shirts, for coming out tonight. And now I'm going to turn it over to our engineer on the project, Jim Wood.
Thank you, Bill. Hey, do we have a laser pointer by chance?
That would be super cool. Oh my gosh.
All right, thank you guys. So I'm Kenneth Wood with Planners and Engineers, the civil on the project. And looking at the site, I wanted to walk through a couple of different things. There are several people in the room that have seen several parts of this presentation several times, but there's a lot of people in the room that have never seen it. So I just want to touch on some of the highlights of the ecology, the hydrology, how we're dealing with things, and then also the mixture of uses across the site. And then we'll go into what we originally filed and where we are now, and the different changes that we're at right now. So bear with me, and if you already seen it, let me run through some of the different things. Alright, it looks different. Alright, so starting up, let's see if I can figure out this laser pointer. This is the ecology parkway, and so what we're talking about in lump sum is basically, how are we handling stormwater? I know with Martin's Landing, it's a very, very big subject. There was a lot of money dumped into the lake and the basically rehabbing the lake into what it is today, and that's something that wants to be protected. And looking at the hydrology maps, one really, really positive thing that we found out is that the discharge from any of the water that would come into the lake and any of the water from the Swift School that comes into this channel comes down along the edge of the property line and actually continues straight to the Chattahoochee, so that water from our site does not enter into Martin's Lake. And we can show you guys on a topo map how that works. Up near the office buildings just north of us, that's the water that actually gets into there. And so that was something we just recently discovered in looking at the entire drainage pathway, and was a really big deal about how that flows off the site. And looking, starting down here, so to get everybody oriented that hasn't seen this, this is the Chattahoochee River that's down here, and this is Georgia 400 that runs along here. So what we're doing is we're collecting, there's two different basins, meaning there's two different parts of the site that actually collect water. So this upper region, which is the village, this is the phase one that I'll talk a little bit more about and what that is. And then here is the existing lake. So if you walk out there today, not too long ago, a couple of weeks ago, we went out there and actually stood on the deck. And the way it looks today is the leasing office of the multifamily facility that's there, it actually goes out onto the water. It's right against the water, and it goes out onto the water. And if you look down, it was a sunny day. I would say that everything I could see out from me was probably a foot deep. You know, it was very silted in. It had a lot of algae, and it was a lot shallower than I anticipated. And so when we started looking at this, we anticipated that the lake had a little bit of depth to it, and that we would be taking the lake, making it even a larger footprint of the lake, and expanding it further, and then making it much deeper so that it could provide a much clearer body of water. It didn't have the very shallow ends that caused the algae, and actually be able to expand this into what you see today here, which is going to be a new lake that expands further to the north. And it will provide almost 5 to 6 times, we're anticipating, the amount of water that is held in there today, just because it's so shallow today. And so that's a very important aspect of what we're doing today for the site, is we're going to take in the storm water around the village. Most of the storm water will be infiltrated. So a lot of times if you're out walking, there's different parts of some sites around downtown. They have, it might look like bricks to you or different pavers, but the rain falls and it actually goes through the paver and infiltrates into the ground. And we're going to handle our storm water like that, and then the volume of water will be handled into the lake. And like I said, the lake will be much larger than it is today, and will hold that water back. Then as you come down from the site into here, this is like a cascading waterfall to get water down to these edges. And we've got some different images we've shown, but essentially we're taking water naturally along the path where if you're going up and down all Alabama today, you can see the sidewalk along the side. So there would basically be water that would move along the side of that in a planted region. And then when you get down here to this is probably where the most impact is going to be as far as beneficial to the ecosystem, different than you've probably seen before. Is right now today, all the interstate water collects down there, a lot of the water from this site, and it essentially looks like someone dumped 5 billion pounds of grass cuttings down there. It's a very strange kind of low area. And so what we're proposing to do is to clean out that entire bottom area and make it what they call a constructed wetland. And essentially, if you walked up on it, it would be a very low body of water that would be planted, and it would basically have a restore an ecosystem down there. And we also have some different images that we've shown before that we're going to have some educational pieces as to, like a little dock that you could walk out on and understand what you're looking at for it. And so after that, you come down and everything comes across to the river. And so we're going to do multiple different areas up here on the site in order to get everything back down eventually to the river and take care of all the stuff on the site in a much different way. The hydrology of the site, you know, right now the site, I don't know if a lot of people know, but today when you actually walk out there, I would say a good portion of the large part of the site, I would say from here all the way up and around the lake, is an existing multifamily complex that's out there today. And so you have a lot of impervious, a lot of open areas. If you walk around the lake, it's completely clear. There's not many trees around the lake today. And so what we're planning on doing is to take that, expand that lake, and then that's where the village is going to be. And so I wanted to kind of walk through, for some of you that haven't heard this or understand what you're looking at on the plan, to make sure that everybody has a fair understanding of what we're proposing as part of the phase one and the rest of the plan. So this, if everybody can see that, that is a for sale residential. That would be high-end residential. That would be for sale residential in a pod here. And about half of that tract is undeveloped. Half of it would be undeveloped. So it has a very large buffer against Mark Landing. This is the proposed school element here. As you come up off Old Alabama, this side of the road is proposed to be multifamily condos and senior housing. And then the side against the interstate here, we're proposing the office development. So the images you see of the office, we're putting those on the interstate because the grade drops off very severely down to Georgia 400, and it can work with the grade the way that it can step. As you get further up in here, this is more multifamily and condo with retail on the bottom. And then this is a pedestrian and vehicular bridge crossing. This is a lake. This is another crossing that comes back over. And then once you're on this side, that is the hotel. This would be a boutique grocery store. And then this whole section here, you'll see some pictures from Mike of the renderings. That's basically the market where the restaurants, the retail, where you'll be able to walk on the street, park on the street, and go down the street and do where you can visit or stay. And then that is residential above that. And so when you see that, that's kind of the makeup of the plan that's going on there. And really the big benefit of the plan is to, let me get one more, is to have a very walkable village. So if you're looking at this in a section, so down here is Old Alabama. This is where everybody drives. And then if you come up, this would be the ecology that we talked about where the water is pouring. And this would be the bridge coming across the road. And then this is actually the lake where it would spill over along the weir and some different things. And so this is the proposed lake that we're looking at. And then this represents a buffer on Old Alabama. So if you're driving on Old Alabama, we're not proposing to do any improvements on Old Alabama. It's a very large road currently today that can support a lot of cars. It's two lanes. And then you also have an existing sidewalk on here when you're coming up through there. And then we'll have a 100-foot buffer that we're proposing to leave. So if you're coming down Old Alabama and you live down that way, when you're turning around some of those corners, the trees that you see going up on that hill, that's what we're proposing to maintain on the hill as you go up through there. And so moving to this, so I don't know if everybody can see this. If not, I can kind of explain it out. So this side is what we originally submitted that Brad and the staff reviewed. This side is where we are today. So there was a lot of questions in some of the different meetings we've had about what changed, what are the exact number of changes, how did it change? And so for the single family and townhome units, that is for sale living townhome detached units and attached units, the original submittal was on 250 homes. This submittal is 125 homes, so it's a 50% difference. The multifamily units are the ones that stayed consistent. That's 1,156 units. It's still 1,156 units, or AKA three complexes in the site. The senior units is 150 units. The senior units we took up on this one, taking out some of the different for sale, and is 270 units. The civic and institutional is 200,000. This is 200,000. That's actually the school. That's the civic use. The office on the original submittal is 1.7 million square feet. On the latest submittal, it's 971,000 square feet. So it's just above half of that. The commercial, the retail, the restaurants, the grocery store, all that different stuff that you see on the plan. The original submittal was 490,000 square feet as a total. The latest submittal is 269,000 square feet as a total going in through there. The hotel is 200, we call them keys or rooms or however you want to say it, but the we kept the hotel at 200 since that's a pinnacle part of the project in there. And then it also lists what the alternative site plan was, which with alternative site plan, if you're looking at the plan, essentially the way it was submitted, not to get everybody confused, but this plan was generated if the school was not part of the approval, then we were requesting this, the for sale section of this, to be approved on this. So I wanted to walk you guys through that and make sure everybody knew, you know, where it was when we submitted it and where it was today. And then I want to pass it over to Mike Beckley so we can go through the architectural so you guys can understand about the buildings and how they lay on the site.
Thanks, Ken. My name is Mike Beckley. I'm one of the architects and designers on the project. Appreciate everybody coming. We've got a few slides here. And we'll start with the plan. You know, as designers, when we're going through a master planning process and going through a zoning process like this, really what we focus on is the land plan, because we've got to get that right. If you don't get the land plan right, the actual buildings themselves doesn't really matter. And so what our focus has been up to this point has really been in making sure that this landscape-driven urbanism that we're talking about actually works. And how do we make that work with the buildings? It's all about the placement of the buildings. The buildings actually have to form the outdoor spaces. So when we have 49% of the site undeveloped, it's really important how we place those structures. We don't want to just put everything in a line right down a main street like you would see like a new urbanism development with a town hall at the end and a row of buildings with cars parked on either side. This site really takes advantage of the landscape. So when you've got a lake like we have, the placement of the buildings really become a border to actually encapsulate the space within. And some of the renderings that we've shown are artistic representations of really how this just might feel. So for us as designers, our work really hasn't even begun. We will get into the architecture of the buildings once we get through the zoning process. But what we want to make sure we get right is the feeling that's inspired from the project. These are watercolor images that have been published a few months back. This one is on the boardwalk that overlooks the lake. So when we talk about Roswell, when we talk about what is it about Roswell that people like, it's really understanding the parts where you all like to go to hang out. Downtown, the outdoor shopping, the sidewalks, the cafes. Those are the things that we pick up on, the cues that we would try to design around. That's what we envision as you go around the boardwalk of the lake. We've shown images like this. Again, another architectural illustration. This is just simply to represent the activity that we hope to see around the lake. We have the waterfall that goes under the bridge. We're creating the trails that Ken talked about coming up from the Chattahoochee River to bring pedestrians and cyclists to come around and actually encircle and actually bring life to the lake. This is an evening shot of the boardwalk. And we have these on boards too. If you guys want to take a closer look when we break out, feel free to come up and take a look and we can ask and answer your questions. But this here is representing the hotel in the background, the multifamily with the residential on the right, outdoor seating and everybody overlooking and walking around the lake. Ken mentioned the shopping. This is a little dark in this image, but this here, this is one of the retail corridors where you've got stone and brick buildings. We're trying to make sure that we recognize the historic materials that are used here in Roswell with the earth tones, stone and brick, wood soffits, places for shops, activity up and down the sidewalk. This is the same shot we had before, but this is an evening shot. So, you know, during the day where you have people coming in from the lake, bikers, hikers, in the evening, you've got a different crowd. You've got people coming to eat, come to a concert. These are the type of things that we try to pick up on with the master plan to make sure that we set the buildings in their proper places so that when we start to design the project, design the buildings, we can make sure that we get these right.
Taking notes, watching my team as they do the presentation. And there were a couple of things that weren't covered, which I thought I should probably jump up and cover. One, I think, is relating to the height of the building and how that conforms to the comprehensive plan. So I don't know, do we have the zoning plan out there? Otherwise, I'll just start showing one here. So the comprehensive plan recommends that heights along Old Alabama would be 3 stories, with buildings transitioning to 6 stories as they move to 400. But on page 29 to 30 of the comprehensive plan, there is, and I don't know if it's necessarily an exception, but there's a recommendation that if greater open space and green space is preserved in a development, to allow that to happen, then they recommend that the heights can be increased. And what that does, obviously, is that reduces the amount of building footprint on the property. So what we have here is we've got 6-story buildings here. We've got 8-story buildings, which are closer to 400. C4, 5, and 6, these areas here, those are 6 stories. 6 stories here in the yellow. Can anybody see that? Or he's pointing. Okay, good. And then the hotel is really the tallest building that we're proposing, and that's for 10 stories. As it relates to the Old Alabama Road corridor, it, as I said, the comprehensive plan recommends 3-story buildings along the old, along the corridor itself. The only place where we're actually putting buildings on the corridor is where the townhomes are. The rest of the buildings in the A1 area, those are pushed back. They're going to be about 75 up to 100 feet away from the corridor. So we won't actually have any buildings along the corridor on the west side of Old Alabama. As you move up Old Alabama, then you can see there's actually considerable green space, several hundred feet in spaces. So the nearest building will be about several hundred feet away from Old Alabama. Now, the only place where we get closer again to Old Alabama is up by Market Street Boulevard, and that's where the dense commercial area is that's essentially going to be across from where the shopping center is, and I think there's a new fire station going in there. So thank you. I just wanted to address that. I don't know, and maybe I should just touch on the process that we're in. I think you all know where this is, the community meeting. We have Planning Commission and then City Council. I will say that we are happy to meet with anyone. We have reached out several times to Martin's Landing leadership in the last couple of months. Have not been able to get a response to sit down and talk to the Martin's Landing Board. But if you'd like to sit down and talk and discuss the plan, then we'd be happy to do that. Thank you.
Can you hear me? My name is Pat Smeaton. I'm a traffic engineer for a company called GD Hill Planners. Since we last talked about the project, since the last time we met with you, we prepared 2 traffic studies. One of them is called a DRI, Transportation Analysis, and this is for the Atlanta Regional Commission and GRETA, which is the Georgia Regional Transportation Authority. It's a requirement for any development over a certain size that you have to do this level of traffic study. The traffic study, the DRI traffic study for ARC and GRETA has been submitted and been approved by GRETA and GRETA, by ARC and GRETA, and they have determined that the project is in the best region of the best interest of the region. that's their terminology. You can take it up with them. You may have seen it because it's published online. The traffic study that we did for ARC and GRETA is a slightly smaller scope. Because this region has been part of an LCI study and a Livable Centers Initiative study over the past few years, and various other corridor studies that Roswell has undertaken, it met a kind of a threshold for what's called an expedited review. So they didn't need to see, they only really wanted to see what was happening along Holcomb Bridge in Old Alabama. So if you've seen that, it's only really analyzed as a few major intersections that are immediately adjacent to the intersection. And the traffic study goes through the whole process of predicting how much traffic each of these land uses will develop. And then we have to assign it onto the roadway network, and we have to analyze AM peak hour traffic, PM peak hour traffic, and then they asked us to analyze noonday traffic during the week, and then Saturday peak hour traffic. So it's a pretty extensive study compared to most DRI studies. And certainly, the DRI study certainly, it showed that there's definitely, you know, we're not going to try to sugarcoat this. There's a traffic impact, it generates a lot of traffic. And in order to get Greta and ARC to sign off on it, we have to show what improvements need to be made at these various intersections to make them operate acceptably. Acceptably, we mean either as good as they would be without this development or better. So we've had to come up with various recommendations for various intersections, and we can talk about that on our breakout groups, to essentially mitigate the traffic impact at those intersections. Now, additionally, and this has not been approved yet by the City of Roswell wanted a much more expansive traffic study, not just those four intersections. I think it winds up being 17 intersections in the whole area, as well as all the intersections internally to the site. We are working with the City of Roswell. We're working out just a few more things on the internal trip analysis, on the internal analysis, and we've been told that they'll make a recommendation within the next month. And that's a similar thing. It's we go through the traffic study, we analyze how the intersection is going to operate in the future with and without this development, and then it shows essentially the incremental impact that this development has on each of those intersections, and then we have to identify improvements to those intersections that will allow those to operate as well as it would if the site wasn't there. So Greta had recommendations that they said needed to be part of this, and the city is likely to have additional recommendations at additional intersections to kind of mitigate the impact that the traffic is going to have. And that's really, I mean, that's what we have, what we've done since we last saw you. And from the breakout group, I can get more into specifics on it, and I can answer questions that you guys may have about traffic.
Thank you, Pat. Pat mentioned the term impact, and with large projects, there is an impact fee. And on this project, it has been calculated that the impact fee is $6.5 million. Of that, $4.4 million is earmarked for traffic improvements to be determined by the traffic folks in the city who decide what it is that is to be considered improvement for the region. So it's not specifically to this, but that is that's a consideration. The number 6.5 was established by the code requirements and procedures that the city gave us. We didn't just reach in here and grab it. Now, in order to get as many questions as possible within the time length, which we've been told is 9 o'clock, we have elected, as Brad says, to break out into stations. Here in this room will be Pat Smeaton and the traffic and myself and development, environment, etc. Out in the outside the doors, there will be two stations. One of them will be Ken on engineering, and the other one will be Mike on architecture. It seemed to us, and suggested by the city, and it seemed to make sense. If we all stay in here, we're cutting the number of questions to theoretically a quarter. So that's that is the procedure, and it'll take just a few moments to move the easels outside. So we'll establish here the two of us will be in this room, and then as soon as we're ready for that.
Can I ask a question just before we get out?
Yes.
Just to find it.
What? The neighborhood meeting, if they would like to break out into groups, or if they would prefer to stay together and hear the answers to the question.
Stay.
Stay together.
they say, your choice, it matters not. We do, however, think it makes sense that whoever is designated ask the question, they can indicate to who they want to answer it. But then, don't please repeat the same question asked in a different way, because we're in a time frame. To that end, we need the mechanics, because we were set up to do it a different way. So, procedurally, let's try this. Let me ask for, I'm pulling this out of the air, guys. Maybe three questions here, three questions here, three questions here, move back and forth. Does that make sense? If that's satisfactory, we'll try it, and if it doesn't work, we'll try something else. All right? First question, and you had to raise this one.
When you're asking a question, please have the mic in your hand so everybody else in the room can hear you.
My question is probably just fundamental, but hopefully it can frame the discussion. Everything that I know from having lived here myself for 8 years is that I have not seen that there is a gap or a void in the environment. We've got a lot of shopping. Whelan Homes has built some monstrosity that, you know, has done nothing more than just to put away a lot of people. So you guys are trying to, there's a word for it, I won't use it, but you know, you're really trying to convince us of something that me personally, I can't speak to the other folks, I don't think we need. You know, I can think of things you need, like hospitals or maybe a school, but the fact that we're going to have some, what is it, a village? I mean, we have the Chattahoochee River, right? We've got a lot of water around here. So the fact that you've got a silt pond with some ducks doesn't seem to be worth the disruption that you're going to cause in the neighborhood and the property values. So I just fundamentally want to know who came up with this idea and who is it that thinks that the majority of the people in here have been like just waiting with bated breath to have the majority of the pretty trees around here torn down and to increase the traffic. And there's no way whatsoever, none of these are going to traffic. It's going to have to be horrendous because you are interjecting that many more people. So I guess I just need to understand what I'm getting for this, because you keep talking like, you know, this is Christmas, but I don't know what it is.
Excuse me, I did hear, several questions on several areas. Let me take a shot. Who came up with your idea? Ideas begin with a land mass, ownership of the property, interest in the development of the property, happens, all of it. And what would be in the best interest? It then segues, if you will, into the UTC, a plan that this community has already adopted. And the first effort is to make sure that whatever is in our mind for the use of the property would fit within that envelope. And we believe it does. And the next question is, how are you going to do the one thing that everyone seems to want, which is preserve open spaces? And so we created the open spaces on a piece of property that ultimately will be developed. This, we believe, is the best way to develop it.
It's not open spaces. It's a normal environment that you're going to decimate about 90% of.
Well, so that's
it's not going to be preserving something if you tear it down.
I guess, in a sense, that's question asked and, at least to a degree, question answered. It is a property of somebody. And somebody with a very, very good, we think, professional team came up with this design. You also touched on the one nerve that everyone in the room agrees on. and that is traffic. There is no quarrel about the fact that traffic is not good in the corridor, and I'm being generous. Traffic is analyzed based on an alphabetized code. So, a traffic situation that is really not very good is given an F, A to F, okay? The traffic situation in this corridor 5 years ago, whatever number of years ago, was an F. The traffic situation today is an F. The traffic situation can be improved, but to what degree can it be improved? We're not sure. I'm talking to a group of persons who I presume are Roswellians, if that's the correct approach. You live in Roswell. But I will tell you, as you know, that the bulk of the confined traffic problem is not generated within the confines of this city, whatever it is that goes into this city. The bulk of the traffic is coming from east and going west. The bulk is coming from Snellville, Stone Mountain, on down the line, and it's headed on out to the west, to Cobb County. And that is the fact. We are very anxious in our interests, and also based on personal knowledge that I have, because I'm not a stranger to traffic problems. There are several things that are in operation now on the traffic situation. One of them is what I call the umbrella road. That's the loop that goes back and forth over the city. It's a study, but it is not done, and it doesn't have a time certain. The second is an early off-ramp that you folks passed a bond for. It was approved, and it has not started yet.
It's disapproved
by water.
Thank
you so much. I hadn't had time to read the paper, but that is the answer to the question. It wasn't disapproved by the citizens of Roswell. It wasn't disapproved by your executives. Early off-ramp project next. It was next by DOT.
And Roswell.
Well, and Roswell. Right. But it is not something that we, in a development next, I still think that's very beneficial from a traffic standpoint. That's it. Next question.
Understanding that the village will be the first portion developed, and I'm guessing that the residential developed later is going to support the village and the businesses there. We have so many vacant space, so much commercial. Granted, it has improved here recently, but I'm wondering who's going to support this retail and what's going to happen to the existing retail if we start going here until all of this development is done and we have a population living there.
Okay, got it. The first phase, I said, was the village, and that area includes residential, commercial, office space, commercial. They feed on each other. You're doing it at the same time. You're doing it to create places for folks to live, and places for folks to shop, and places for folks to exist, enjoy in the location. Will it be disruptive to other businesses? Unknown. It's like asking me how long is a piece of string. I really don't know. But I do know this, that every time in this metro area and any other metro area that you have started new projects, then the new projects did well, but new people came in, new businesses occupied old business, and it's just the cycle. That's the best answer I can give to the question.
This is a question directed to Ken with regard to the hydrology study. I was just questioning whether or not he has examined the capacity of the infrastructure to handle the volume of water coming from this project directly underneath Riverside Road and into the small little area that is currently there.
We've looked at several different areas. The area you're talking about for the question would be the runoff that comes down the Riverside Road at this point. The majority of the water on the site actually is going to get into this lake and actually discharges through this part of the site. And so it doesn't get all the way down to the river at this portion of the site.
Will the lake be empty? Is that where the water could go into an empty lake? Or will it be full and no water can get in?
No, it's not going to be completely full. It'll have freeboard where it can rise and lower, but it'll have plenty of volume in there, as you can see the size of it. So from this point right here, this portion of the water would flow. Now, inside these developments, as we met with Roswell Stormwater, we're planning on having, you know, pervious pavers and different type of infiltration to handle the majority of the storms. As the other storms come down, we'll actually store it in the constructed wetland that we talked about here at the bottom. And then, yes, we have to make sure that the culvert can handle that capacity. But if you look at the flood maps, during a 100-year event, and this is nothing that we caused or nothing that we're not going to make it any worse. We're only going to help, because right now you have an entire multifamily complex with no detention on it discharging down this way, and the interstate discharging down this way with no protections. But today, in the 100-year storm, that section of the road is underwater. And so you're not causing anything to be done. All the stuff that we're going to do and take in from the site will actually be a benefit, because the majority of what we're trying to do is infiltrate, which is a lot different than what's happening today.
First question from this side.
I've been to several of these meetings, and I keep hearing that you want this property to look like downtown Roswell. I want you to point out to me where in downtown Roswell is the almost 1,500 condos, the 10-story buildings, and the million square feet of commercial space. This does not look like downtown Roswell. This looks like midtown Manhattan. Yeah.
Thanks, good question. You know, I wouldn't say our intent is to make it look like downtown Roswell. We want to take the parts of downtown Roswell that works and integrate it into this development. And that is the walkable nature of downtown, the pedestrian friendly. I mean, Ken and I had dinner there before we came over, and that place is crowded. It's busy. People like being there. That's the type of atmosphere that we want to create in this development. We don't want to duplicate that, but we want to take those rich materials and tones and that sense of place and create something here at Riverwalk.
Next question from the center.
I think we all understand that Roswell would like to get the revenue that's gone up to Alpharetta with Avalon, but honestly, we can get to Avalon and North Point within 10 minutes. Why do we need another development of this magnitude in this area?
That's a good one. Your lead-in sort of gave me the lead-in for my opinion answer. There was a leapfrog over Roswell from Sandy Springs to Alpharetta.
Yes.
And I understand that has some benefit and it has some disadvantages. So I think that it's our effort to have something here that is different from Avalon. Now, you introduced Avalon. Avalon is a table flat piece of land that was and is well-developed into what I term, and others, a big box development. That's Evelyn. This is totally different from an environmental and topographic situation. And therefore, we believe high degree of desirability to do things that Avalon does not do. And that's, I guess, the answer. This does what we think Avalon and others do not do.
What?
On a smaller scale and an easier walk, you said you can get in your car and drive to Avalon. It's true. We're hoping that a lot of people are going to want to live, work, and enjoy on this 106 acres. That's the desire. It's an opinion, I know, but that's the desire. Next question, if you look.
Yes, sir. Yeah, 7 years ago, I ran for city council. And part of the people in this room right now are in that category. And I ran for one reason, that was to fight the Charlie Brown one, we call it the Charlie Brown Project. And I had a lunch with Charlie Brown and his son in a private room, which at his request, which means it was probably recorded. So I went somewhere on tape expressing an interest in, I'm looking at this whole project, this is Charlie Brown on steroids. I saw Charlie Brown and I said, you know, Charlie, I see your energy and I see yours now. I said, where are your service roads? I see no service roads here. We're 18-wheelers going to be delivering all day long and all night long to this project. I also asked where the parking. And he said, oh, Dennis, don't worry about it. We're going to go underground with the parking. I said, really? I said, then you're familiar with the rock. And at that point, his son stood up and said, Dad, we have another meeting. And his dad said, no, sit down. Whether you know it or not, ladies and gentlemen, this entire project, half the city of Roswell, all of Martin's Landing, sits on a geological rock that is as large as the Soul Mountain, except it's underground. It's 100% granite, impervious. So I said to Charlie, I said, well, that requires blasting it. I said, do you realize that that rock goes under Martin's Dam? All the foundations of Hillside, all the foundations of North Shore, and South Shore sits on that granite dome. If you go up Highway 9, turn to the right, why do we have three lanes? Because it's granite to the left and granite to the right. I spent the last 10 days working with an environmental group here in Atlanta. I said, are you familiar with the rock? Yes, we are. What about this lake? Quote, there will never be a lake. Really? Because he said, it's totally impervious soil. I said, well, go by there when there's a rainstorm. You'll watch brown, muddy water roaring out of the thing across the sidewalk under old Alabama and roaring down the street. And it ends up the Chattahoochee River, which, if you look today, is totally silted under Georgia 400. So one question is, where are your service roads and parking garages? What are you going to do with totally impervious slab?
You just served me a shot into my wheelhouse, and I thank you, because I'm not going to take time to give a complete commercial, but I am going to say this, that geology is not a stranger to me. I told you I'm a professional engineer. I was vice chairman of the MARTA board when we actually did build the subway system. And for 5 years, I did that. We went under Peachtree, city of Decatur, cut and cover some, deep bore some. I candidly know a little bit about it. But your question is excellent. And I know there's rock there. Remember, I have successfully developed 1,500 acres adjacent to Stone Mountain Park, the largest granite outcropping in the world. And I did not shoot one stick of dynamite. Not one. Not one. That's a fact. And the reason is, I knew where the rock was. You're absolutely right that there's rock stratification. And you're absolutely right that we're going to have to do something with it. We're going to go through it. We're going to get rid of it, or we're going to go over top of it. But it is something that I'm familiar with because this is my job. If we get on with this, and I know why. Secondly, on parking. The parking is going to be a combination of underground, but not like a London subway system. One deck, maybe two, but the rest of it is going to be in decks that are within these buildings. That's an how tall are the parking decks? However necessary that we need, I'll throw it to Ken, but that's the answer to the question. That's where it's going.
Is that like some alarm?
You
can bust this way. So, in looking at the question in here, So, in looking at the question about where is the parking for the development, so the parking for the school is all around here inside the school here. It also has two levels of deck at the school. For this part of the development, this is a double-sided, it's basically two decks side by side that would support the retail as well as the residential. So if you have six stories of the one story of retail, five stories of the residential above it, it would be a six level deck, meaning you can drive up to the sixth level and walk in on your level on there. I don't know where to go. All right, so, and looking at here, so all these you can see the dark little squiggly lines that are inside these, it's a building surrounding a parking deck. So that is a freestanding parking deck. Like if you go to a lot of different areas, you can see Sandy Springs has plenty of developments where it wraps around the parking decks, the office buildings, the multifamily, the condos. And so those are the parking structures that you see. Probably the hotel is probably the only one that we're hoping would be actually subterranean, just because hotels kind of function in that facility where they need the parking to be directly underground, because the majority of it is you pull up and you have valet that takes it from you, so it's not self-park in there. But each one of these facilities could stand on its own, and keep in mind that is how it's zoned. It's zoned into a district, meaning, you know, this, what is called out, if you can see A1, like that is a site right there. And so within that site, it has to park itself, it has to meet the requirements of the EDC itself.
Where are the service roads?
So the service roads and looking at the different stuff. So for instance, these are the condos. This road correct on here, this is a main road, and then off of that road, you know, within a little slot here on the side of the deck, if you've seen a parking deck, they basically have either roll up or pull out doors where you can essentially roll out a compactor or a dumpster in this case and pick up the trash. For the office and the restaurant and all that stuff that has the bigger needs doing it, this road, if you can't see it, this up here is actually the existing Raintree Drive. If you drive out there today, that road exists and that road will be continued as part of this development. And so all of this is loaded on the back side, on the 400 side, in order to service it going down through there. The grocery store here is intended to have a turnaround in the front that would be able to come in and service for a large truck. For the retail, none of this is national retail. This is all, you know, small restaurants, small clothing stores, retail stores, your nail shop, stuff that you would go to on a normal day or into an evening. And so those, just like if anywhere else, would load through the front door. The trash would actually be picked up on the ends of the development so that they come through the same thing, a swinging door. Now they have to be serviced. You have to have wide sidewalks out the back so that you can take the facility stuff down to that centralized place. But That's how we do it as far as the way it looks for service and the different type of service behind the office buildings for there.
Question on this side.
Hi, my name is Nydia Jacoby, and this is the first time I've seen this plan, and wow, where to begin? percentage of open space that's there. And I would like to think that the majority of people in this room, from an aerial view, that's not the concern. The concern is the density that you're talking about. Right now, based on what is currently on that property and what you're proposing, you are over quintupling the number of people who are going to be living in that area. And if you have ever had to drive down Old Alabama to try to get on 400 in the morning, that is a very scary proposition. His comment just now that you don't have national retailers for the stores, so you're going to go and put in lots of things that we usually find in strip malls, I'm telling you that's not going to draw people. You yourself brought up the development plan. The comment that you have not made is, how many variances have you actually asked for based off of that plan? Because I'll be honest with everybody in this room, if you have not had to ask for any variances to put forth this plan, then ladies and gentlemen, I think we have a problem with our city council and city planning department. Over there.
Stream buffer variance. There's no nothing else in the totality of the plan.
So the for whatever, however you feel about the UDC, we are not asking for any variances from the UDC requirements except for this the streams, which is in fact the lake. The lake is really a stream. That was dammed up when the apartment complex was built. So in order to be able to get in there and do the refurbishment on the lake and actually use it for the detention, we'll need to get a stream buffer variance from the state EPD, Army Corps of Engineer approval, and then also a variance from Roswell City Council on that stream. But that is the only variance that we're asking. That's the lawyer in me talking. I don't mean to be pedantic. The height is called a conditional use permit, it's actually part of a rezoning process. It's not actually a variance, although I guess in general language we are asking it to be varied. But like I said, it does conform to the comprehensive plan recommendations. We've talked about this.
Yes, we
have look at page 29 and page 30 of the comprehensive plan. That's it recommends that if there's a certain amount of green space and could be granted, yes, but it's still a recommendation. And then the comprehensive plan is not law. The comprehensive plan is not law. Comprehensive plan is a recommendation. So we are following that recommendation. But as you all know, because if you did not know this, you would not be wearing red shirts. The rezoning is something that could be granted. I mean, we understand the process that we're in. And as I said, that's why we have reached out many times to have meetings. We have had a lot of meetings. We'd like to continue to talk to you about this. As far as the question goes, conditional use permit for the height and stream buffer variances.
So just to be very clear, this density is, you do not need any kind of request to change the density. This density is in the plan and this is?
As part of the CX zoning district, yes. So we are currently zoned as an office park. We're currently zoned for a little over 1 million square feet of office. So that is tomorrow morning, I could go to the planning department and submit a permit and build 1 million square feet of office. So you want 8,000 people arriving at this property in their cars for a 9 o'clock start. Nobody thought State Farm would put in 1.8 million square feet of office next to the Dunwoody Mart station. So I don't know why I would be so sure. But what we're trying to do, I'm sorry, in case you question,
But what we're trying to do is do a mixed-use development where people can actually live, and maybe they walk down the street, and that's where they work. That's why State Farm. That's why State Farm is actually opening up an office building next to a development that has entitled for 3,000 apartments and condos there. I'm sorry, we got off track.
John Thomas, I'm going to let my other neighbors talk about the specifics of what's going into the project, because that's not of my interest at this point. But one of the things that was addressed was the traffic plan and the impact there. You said yourself that we currently rate as an F on a scale of A, B, C, D, F being the worst, and that's correct?
At the intersection or the corridor of Holcomb Bridge and 400, the answer is yes.
Okay. Well, that being said, the density, if you can do it, hey, do it. But I tried to get here tonight by going down Riverside to Roswell Road, and I had to turn around because the traffic was so bad it was backed up all the way to the red light at Riverside. That's a two-lane road that goes down that's not affected or not being developed by you, but that's where an awful lot of people travel. The Dogwood Road going up to 400 is a nightmare. All of these other intersections are going to be affected because people are going to avoid the complex that's here to get to work quicker or get to their shopping quicker. Is there anything in the plans, your plans, or has the city council thought of anything that they're going to address to deal with these traffic issues that are going to be affected throughout the entire city, especially East Roswell, by this development?
Well, to answer that, I'm really gonna, can you hear me?
Yep.
To answer that, I'm gonna talk about what your city has done. The city did a Holcomb Bridge corridor study a couple of years ago. And they identified, they looked at all the land use that, all the open land like this that was going to get developed. In fact, they assumed a much higher level of development on this site. And they did a very in-depth, and there was a lot of public involvement, in-depth analysis on how do we deal with the short-term, mid-term, long-term transportation issues along the Holcomb Ridge corridor and the adjacent streets. And they've come up with a huge list of improvements. And you know, they went out to the bond and they funded, I think, four of them, even though the one that certainly got next. However, our traffic study and our project is being designed because the city, right now they run into a roadblock with DOT, but it's a good project and everyone thinks it's a good project. So I believe the city is going to keep, you know, we think by 2025, we think it's a project that's still going to happen. I'll get you. But they have identified a huge number of projects. Intersection improvements, interchange improvements, a long-term big interchange improvement at 400 and Holcomb Bridge. So, you know, the city hasn't just, you know, put their head in the sand and said, hey, we don't think there's an issue out there. They come up with the list, they put it into their master transportation plan. In fact, almost every recommendation that's coming out of our study is already one of the recommendations that the city's already done.
Let me add what I was saying there too. We said it's F already.
Yes, sir.
Yes, there's not a G and H.
No.
You said the DOT and Greta and all those, because I work for the state.
Yep.
They said that you have to make this project meet or exceed the current rate. Well, you can meet an F without
We actually have to, if it's an F, we have to improve it to an E. That's actually not the case. They don't make us. That if it's a D, we have to keep it a D. If it's an F, we actually have to improve it to an E. But certainly, you know, I work with a developer who always talked about an F5 or an F6. You know, he used to call them that. Certainly, but in reality, we're almost all the metro Atlanta in the peak hours are level service F. I could probably name 1,000 intersections in metro Atlanta that are F. It's just a matter of fact, that's what we live in. Georgia 400 is an F all the time.
Over here, there we are. It's like getting on a holiday when you leave the city of Atlanta and you leave the 400 corridor and come into Martin's Landing, I've got deer I have to stop for. I've got ducks I have to stop for. I've got all this stuff that I have to do, and I don't hear anything. It's peaceful. Yeah, I live in a parkland. I live in a resort. And this will greatly impact this us because these people will use our roads. They'll cut through our streets as well.
Study doesn't agree with you. You can't add 26,000 cars a day and not have there be more congestion. There's certainly going to be some more congestion. Well, what I would tell you, though, is that this level of development, the reason ARC supports these kind of projects, and ARC, if you guys ever deal with ARC, all they do now is try and support and try and push nodal development. This is nodal development. It's smart development might be a bit of an oxymoron, but the fact of the matter is if we had this level of development occur in individual sites along Holcomb Bridge Road, then every single trip would be automobile and every single trip would go on Holcomb Bridge Road. So it may not, you know, all development is going to generate traffic, but it is smarter. It's not smart development because I think it's a bit of an oxymoron, but it's smarter development. We're talking about, you know, 15, 20% of the trips actually occurring on site. Atlantic Station, we did the studies for that. I did the studies for that. And we assume 20%, and it's more like 40%. You know, I'm not saying it's not going to generate more traffic, but if there's a market and there's going to be that much development that's going to occur in the region and it all occurs as an individual land use, then every one of those trips gets on the road every time. And this is a smarter level. It's the kind of development that the region is pushing. It's the kind of development that really the country's pushing. And it's the kind of development that people want to go to. They want to go to a place where they can walk around. Nodal development, look at City Woodstock. Nodal development is where the majority of real money is going into big development in the region. And ARC, in their state of the region, they say every single year, they talk about the benefits. So again, I'm not trying to sugarcoat this and say it's not going to generate traffic, but it is a better form of development than if it's all individual. And we met with MARTA. The one thing I didn't mention is we met with MARTA. MARTA has a very real plan, and the legislature lets them increase their sales tax by half penny. There's a real potential of having rail come up to this. We've talked about that, about redesigning. We talk about traffic. You said that every one of these roads is level of service. You said 400 is. Well, if we're not, you know, Georgia DOT has no real plans to increase the capacity of 400. But if we can get some of those cars into a train, then it starts to, you know, it's all part of the solution.
Georgia,
infrastructure
first. All
right, I got to let somebody else ask the question.
My name is Kevin Kelly. I'm going to ask a slightly different question because a lot of us have been battling with redistricting over the last couple of years, actually. And I want to know, have you guys done a study to find out how many school-age children are going to be part of this new development? Have you consulted with Fulton County and their current efforts? Are there any new public schools planned? Or are we just going to stuff everybody into what already exists?
I can take a stab at that. So the what we're proposing in this type of development, we're not targeting families. There's no part of this development that is targeting families.
So townhomes are not targeting families.
The apartments that we're doing are mostly 1 and 2 bedrooms, not 3 and 4 bedrooms. So we're trying to target more young professionals, people that will work in the area, young families, like that don't have kids. So that's the target audience. That's what you're seeing a lot of the trend with a lot of these type of developments. It's just a reality, like it or not. It's the townhomes that are here against Martin Landing. I would imagine there'll be, you know, several families that would purchase in there. It'll be very nice. It'll be very wooded. It has a ton of buffer around it. The houses will be very, very upscale, but they'll also be very cluttered. Very low impact, very low maintenance yards. And typically, what we're seeing across the entire United States is that those type of developments where you shrink the yard down, it's more conducive for empty nesters to move out of their big home with a big yard and the maintenance and move into a lower maintenance, more eco-friendly type of home. And so that's what we're proposing on here, and then the multifamily that's in here would be geared toward mostly one and two bedroom homes. And then the other type of developments is office and stuff, which would bring people in, bring families in, but not to live. It's not the target.
Okay.
What about school? Excuse me,
Bill.
Scotty, just kidding.
Good evening. My name's Ian Kahn. I've lived in Martin's Landing for 13 years, and I have a follow-on to the answer that you just gave. Have you done a demographic study of the people that live in Roswell and live in this part of town? Have you looked around the room? Tell me how many millennials are sitting here tonight. Most of us have kids that live in this area, that are growing up in this area. We're concerned about the overcrowding of the schools. The Holcomb County just opened a new school on Highway 9. They're building a new school, or rebuilding Esther Jackson Elementary in Martin's Landing right now, and we're already being told that within 5 years it's going to be inadequate to the needs. And now you're talking about, you're going to look here, look at us, and say, well, we don't think families are going to want to live here. I mean, come on, Roswell is about families. This isn't an area of town where because that's where the jobs that they're going after are. This is a suburban community. This is a bedroom community.
Okay, so I have to answer.
Well, the question is, have you done the demographic study that shows that millennials are going to live here?
I'll let the ownership answer the, I haven't done a demographic study. I'll let them answer that part of it. But, you know, in my experience in zoning specifically, the millennials that we're talking about don't usually come out in the zoning here. Why?
But,
I know they live here. I talk to them through here all the time. So,
right behind me.
I can't speak.
I'll answer your question. Millennials live here.
I'm one of them. I've got a beautiful wife. We don't have any kids. We live in a home way too big for us. And we love it. We live off on Riverside Road. It's gorgeous. Most millennials don't come to these meetings because I kind of want to stab myself in the leg with a needle for how painfully boring it is. All right? And it's nothing against you, but I want to let everyone know that millennials live here. And this development, you guys, I want, you know, my shirt's actually kind of how I feel about it. I'm kind of against it, and I'm kind of for it. You know? So I look at this, I say, man, this is really nice. It'd be nice to walk up the Riverside Road, go have go to the restaurant, you know, all that jazz. And we talk about the Avalon, you talk about Atlantic Station. If you don't, you have no national chains coming in here, I don't see how you're going to support 1,200 apartments, you know, and I don't see how you're going to support these big commercials. I think I like the idea of it. I think you guys have a good idea. I think your plan is pretty poor, and it's, you know, because I'm sitting here and I'm like the one guy in this room that's got like a 51% chance of approving of this, and you're not really convincing me. It's nothing, you know. This is just not really wowing. At the same point, the only thing that you said tonight that's really made me really happy is, which I mean, everyone here is probably about to, you know, light fires and throw it at me and all that jazz. It's fine, I can take it. I mean, you talked about MARTA, and I, you know, as a millennial, if I could get on MARTA, I would take MARTA because driving that 400 sucks. You know? At the same point, sorry for going on the soapbox, I'll stop after this. The Port of Savannah is being expanded. When the Port of Savannah is expanded, trucks are coming through Atlanta. When trucks come through Atlanta, cars need to get off the roads. And if you're going to build a MARTA station, part of this development to, you know, get people off of 400, get them down. So I work at Northside Hospital. Get me to Northside Hospital. Get me back. I never have to get on 400. I would love you forever. I think that sounds like a great idea. Yeah. So let, yeah, as my generation says, yeah, let's be more open. I'm not saying you guys, I mean, you guys are right. A lot of this that you're against, I'm kind of right there with you. But this isn't like a 100% bad idea. And the MARTA thing's actually not really a terrible idea either. So maybe we can work on this. Like, maybe we don't need 1,200 apartments. Yeah. I mean, when I sit here and saw that your replan went from 250 homes or townhomes to like 125, I was like, no, dude, that's the wrong one to cut. Cut the 1,200 apartments, you know? Let's go from like 1,200 to 600 apartments. I'm done.
Awesome.
connections are here. I live here, I support it as well. I very much think that this is everything that I want for an advanced society. I mean, we are educated people, and we like being together, otherwise we wouldn't have already moved here together.
Go to Montana.
I'm from Montana. I'm here with you. Like, this is more people than there are in my entire state back home, right? But when I want to be together, it's just that I also want to be able to go out and do some things and not have to get on the roads. I haven't lived here nearly as long as you have, so I haven't been responsible for voting in all of the past traffic problems that we already have today. But stopping progress like this isn't the only way to go about it. Really, honestly, we can add so much value to our community if we can have some progress and some change here. And there's going to be more, there's going to be places for everybody. And the people that move in here, they're not going to be blue. I mean, they're going to go to church and they're going to go to the grocery stores and they're going to have happy lives right here with us. I would welcome newness and change here.
Hi folks, my name is Jenny Lim and I am on the School Governance Council for Esther Jackson. So I'm going to speak to them and a couple of other items. One, according to the school board, if we tear down 1,500 apartment homes, we will lose almost a third of our students, and Esther Jackson will be on the school closure list because we won't have enough students. I know.
You said 1,500.
No. Well, I'm sorry. The apartment homes, if we remove them, we are talking about removing a third of our students and putting Esther Jackson on the school closure list. You take away those apartment homes tomorrow, you don't give us anything else or any new people to replace them for 10 years while you're completing this project, and our school gets closed. This is an issue. But this is not just an issue for you, it's also an issue that's happening with the redistricting, and that's a bigger issue than just this one. The second thing I wanted to ask you about is hearing all of the different stages of this project. I've heard 5,000 cars a day, I've heard 10,000 cars a day, and now I'm hearing 26,000 cars a day added to where there are already too many. I mean, you can't get around 26,000 cars a day. That just, it never gets any better from there.
So just to reply to the one of the questions about the schools, from what I know about the process, is let's say if the project was approved and we went forward, the existing apartments as part of the de-leasing, what they call it, a de-leasing process. They have a company that actually reloads, takes into account school districts and where they are and finds housing, helps them relocate housing so that life doesn't change that much as part of the de-leasing. I do know that.
Good. I'm Tracy. I just want to follow up on that question too. So what happens when Esther Jackson closes and all of our students here in Martin's Landing don't have a place to go to school? So I mean, we would love to make it more of a neighborhood community, but so you're saying that you don't anticipate any volume of students coming from this?
No, it's just that the intent of the design is not to have 1,000 families moving to. It's just not the style of it. It's not
right. There's no parks. Field. There's no green space. There's nowhere for children to run or play.
But there's a lot of
what children?
Where?
There's
asphalt, but
no, there's a lot children. Of that. It's very there's passive recreation. There's a river. But the way it is geared is this part of the development. This part of the development is 3- and 4-story homes, but they are very clustered homes. Preference, I don't know, but what the market is telling us across the United States right now, and I'll let the developer speak to this, is that the cluster communities, very high end, very nice, so that when you come down from a much larger house, much larger maintenance responsibility, and that you want to keep your how nice the house is, how nice the kitchen, the master bedroom, and all those certain spaces are, that when you clustered it here, you take away the maintenance of the yard, you have an HOA that takes care of those costs. That's what you're looking for. Most of the time, it's either empty nesters or young professionals. And so that's what we're targeting with the development.
Okay, one other quick question. Yes. Have you done any noise studies? Because I see that there's a very large stadium being built right behind my house. And so I'm wondering, are there going to be additional concerts? When you mentioned concerts, are they going to take place at the stadium? And just the traffic and all of this,
sure.
All this new development. We already hear Georgia 400 traffic because of the new development at Esther Jackson. They tore down a bunch of trees. So we already hear a little bit of 400. I anticipate us feeling like we live on Georgia 400 if all these trees get tore down, and then we're going to be at a rock band concert. Because
right.
It's
going to
be
so
in my backyard.
I can let the school speak to that because there's
okay,
a
so
time.
Noise
there's
a what kind of noise volume will we expect?
Sure. Archie Wanamaker, I'm a real estate broker and represent the Swiss School. No concerts, it's an athletic field. And so the school, you have to realize, will be independently owned and operated by the Swiss School, who is now here in the city of Ross.
Will there be lights on the stadium?
There'll be lights on, yes.
PA system.
Yep, and but there's a, and our architect and our engineer are here tonight, so I apologize. I can't get into the specifics. If I pull my iPad, I can. But there is a, one, it'll be within the ordinance from a PA standpoint. Two, there's a, I want to say it's called silence sound. I'll pull it up. But what it does is basically the audio will die as it hits the property line. And as far as lighting goes, the lighting goes down. Well, I'm sure they don't have that. But in regards to your question, there won't be any concerts there. The fields are used solely by the school.
And,
So, in looking at this, one thing that it's hard to see on a two-dimensional map like this. So, the Martin's Landing is here. Okay, this area right here is probably about 50 feet below the state elevation of where the school is going to be. Now, the school is going to be built out in stages. So, they're starting off with one building, then some parking, and then it'll evolve from there. This right here is an undisturbed buffer. There's very healthy trees in there that would remain in there. And as far as the noise and the lighting, you know, I don't know their plans. I have been up to, the new park up in Cartersville, that really cool facility. And I have seen the cutoff lighting that the new technologies where it literally does immediately stop down. And so I'm guessing that's what would be provided, but we can follow up with you guys on information about that. Brad Howard.
My name is Dan McLagan, and I am president of the PTA at Esther Jackson. I also am a resident of Marquise Trace Apartments for 10 years. My question is kind of greedy, I guess, selfish. You talk about relocating or de-leasing the residents that live in the current apartment complex that do make up a third of Esther Jackson's population. Those people that live in there do not have the funds, number one, to live outside of that apartment complex because of the value pricing that is in there. Have you decided where possibly they would be de-leased to? Because currently they would not be going anywhere else besides, or they would not be going to Esther Jackson upon your de-leasing because there's no other apartment complexes that feed into Esther Jackson now or any restructuring or redistricting that the school has. So where are these people going to be de-leased? Has it been bought yet?
I'll let Bill go over the phasing because there's a lot of phases to the apartment.
The phase one that I've discussed before does not remove all of the apartments. It removes a percentage of the apartments. As we move into future phases, they will be removing other apartments. As far as relocation is concerned, we're going to follow the rules that are both dictated by business, by regulations, and by our sensitivity to those persons who have been tenants, some for a long time. So it's not going to be done in a, guess what, there's a notice on your door. It's going to be done and done over a period of time. And if you recall on my timeline, this is a 2018 concern, and we will have lots of time for early warning and to address the exact items that you just brought up. Yes,
over here. Over here.
Good. Go ahead.
Yeah, I just have a couple questions. I mean, I actually live right on the border of Alabama, so this would be right against me. And like some people, I mean, I understand that, you know, we're going to have progress. I expect to see a development here. You know, my whole thing is, has there been any studies on how much impact will be on the actual, like, the riverfront parks that we have? I know everybody's talking about you'll live, work, and play here, and you'll use the wonderful facilities that you'll make, but, you know, people will, that live there, don't want to use the riverside park, which is also, you know, already very overcrowded, because a lot of people that come to the river don't even live in this area. So there's an impact on that, and want to find out if there's been a study about that. And then also, as much as, you know, most people would not like to see MARTA, I actually feel like, you know, it's a necessity. We're going to need it. Is there any plans for future development that you're laying aside if MARTA was to, in the future, want to come? I mean, because if you're going to spend that kind of money to invest it, obviously it's a turn of profit, which is fine, which we all have to do. But, you know, is there anything in your plan that says that's being laid aside for future MARTA development?
Let me take the second part of that first. As far as MARTA is concerned, yes. Initial discussions with MARTA were specific in the location or desirable location for MARTA on the station, and it will be on our side of 400. Actually, MARTA will come up on the opposite side and then cross over. So it will get over to the east after having traveled a long distance from Sandy Springs on the west. We're looking at right up in kind of the corner of the property, which is up in this side near the intersection of Holcomb Bridge. That's as far as the study or this dialogue has gotten. But they are as serious as our attack about wanting to have a station in this area. And they believe, and we concur, that we have the ideal location. Anticipating a question, I've already outlined some experience that I have with the Metropolitan Atlanta Transit Authority. Time in government is a time when reached. So I don't know how long it's going to be. I do know the funding is going to be a major issue. I do know that it's going to be dependent on additional sales tax revenue. But I also believe that as that line moves up north, it is going to come to Roswell, and we think and they think that ours is the best location. A senior moment, what was the first part of the question?
Parks.
Parks on the river.
The impact on the river.
On the
parks along the river. I know this, it'll be studied, and it certainly will come up during the LDP phase. I'm a corporate member of the Chattahoochee Nature Preserve, and I'm as fond of that as I'm sure anybody else in this room is. Don't know that this would impact greatly other than our resolution of the traffic situation down in that area. We had initially discussed having a roundabout down at Riverside and Old Alabama. That was brought up and put to bed because a roundabout does not solve any problem. Actually, it probably exacerbates the problem by forcing you into turns and all that stuff. But that's all going to be settled, I believe, when the city decides what it is that they believe is the highest priority on this expenditure of our impact fees to serve the best interest of the citizens.
Let's go.
Just on the
parks
thing before. It'll be super quick. Just to answer further on the park stuff you're asking on the back wall. So the idea of it is, yes, people are going to use the parks. You guys have awesome parks here. One of the problems is a lot of people, as you said, they drive to the park and park. This development is the closest proximity to that park. And so to be able to run down and get on the trails and run is what we envision. But keep in mind, a lot of people that haven't seen the presentation before don't know this, and I glanced over and I apologize, but our mission in this is we are trying, besides taking the trails up and through the development, is we're going to work with Steve and the transportation department. We're trying to connect across, under or over, one of the two, without having to walk across Holcomb Bridge, but we're trying to connect a big creek so that the parks on the river can be expanded to the big creek trails that go further north. And so that's the main vision.
You tried to run up Old Alabama. Running down is fine, but running up is, you're the only one I think can do it. Walk the property.
Okay, good evening. Well, I want to thank the team and their time for presenting this material. There's one thing notably absent. I've been to several of these meetings now. And I'm pretty upset over some of the scope and some of the things, especially the traffic. I did a calculation. I sat at the red light going up on the Holcomb Bridge. And you figure you can do 20 to 25, 30 cars per minute every 3 or 4 minutes for a red light change. It works out something around 6,000 or 7,000 cars. You're talking 26,000 cars. But that's not the question. The question here is really, in this plan, you repeatedly keep presenting 1,000 units over here, 500 or 600 over here. We've cut them to 250. There's been no compromise on the scale of the size of the plan. I think a lot of people in here would be amiable to development, reasonable development, maybe not 1,000, maybe 200 or 300 high-end apartments. Don't ignore the fact that people are gonna have families here. The 250, you cut to 140 townhome things. Sprinkle them out. Don't get so close to the river. Don't be so greedy as to go 10 and 12 stories. Be happy with 5 or 6 stories. I don't think I want to see these 10-story edifices as I get off of my ramp. It's bad enough to see the noise walls. So here's the deal. I haven't heard a single word from you guys, no thought or wielding any additional facts on a compromise. You have not compromised. Your value equation is set at X number of dollars per square foot per acre for the entire project. And I'm a network engineer, and I can tell you right now, this flow of networking of cars and people doesn't fit this topology. No matter what studies you show me, you're a network engineer, you do it with traffic, I do it for networks. This project needs a compromise. You guys want to go forward, you don't want to have a long-standing battle with us and city council and the mayor because we're prepared to go forward. You come back with a reasonable compromise. You're right, the property is a jewel. It does need development. It needs reasonable development, not needing to leave a legacy for people.
High-end townhomes and apartments
and empty nesters, we don't line up to work retail. We don't line up to work in the hotel. I'm a telecommunications engineer, networking engineer for a national company. Yeah, I don't work here. I can't walk to anything I would work. And I also don't hear any real amenities listed other than the light that you're putting in, telling you that there's retail closes. To address that question, what I'd like to see would be a presentation that shows, as several people have asked about the density, is can the community support the footprint of density for retail, business, office space, and apartments? Do we have an open need now, or what do our occupancy rates look like? How are they impacted by this project over the course of its build? In addition to all the other development, we could literally see out the windows in daylight as to how it competes with that, because an awful lot of the businesses we see are just moving from one part of Roswell to another part of Roswell, and then we have hundreds of acres of empty buildings. We have a massive three-story office complex just across Old Alabama from this development that has never been more than 20% occupied in the 14 years I've lived here. So that if you want to show me that there's a need for it, show me a map that shows the region, that shows that there's a need for it, and how that has changed over time, because an awful lot of this just looks like moving the shell around and the pea moves back and forth from one shell to the other, not new businesses coming in. And for those that do the numbers, this is approximately 3/4 of the home units in all of Martin's Landing, big chunk of folks, in under 20% of the space. That's a lot of density.
I'm going to take the first part, and then Bill can take the marketing side of it in there. So just as a scenario, these office buildings along the back here could be professional offices, they could be technology, they could be whatever it is that we're seeing, and new development stirs new interest. And right now there's not a lot of new office available in Roswell, so maybe the big companies aren't moving here for that reason, and that's why you're seeing them jump and go to other places. So if you lived here, if you lived in the house now, and you wanted to move in a lower maintenance condominium that's just as nice as far as the finishes and the crown and everything, you could live here, you could go across the street to work, and then you could come get a bite to eat, and then you could work out back at your condo. And so each individual type of development, each multifamily or condo development, or the for sale here, will have its own amenities that are private to each. And then it also will have the amenities of the surrounding area. You have the amenities of being able to walk down to the river, you have the amenities around the lake, you have the amenities that are all right here in downtown. When you guys have a live after 5, it is the most crowded I see Roswell ever, and that's just so people can come out, hang with each other, get a bite to eat, and enjoy being outside. And that's very similar to the atmosphere we're creating here. So as far as can't work here, or can't do different things or amenities, it's all here as far as we're planning it. And then I want to let Bill speak to as far as the rents and any of that stuff that was brought up next.
Market driven is the term that many of us deal with, and then projections of time. It all takes time. And one of the things that we in my industry and profession and others are trying to avoid is piecemealing something, shooting from the hip, and missing the opportunity for comprehension. And that's what this is, it's a comprehensive plan. I led off my conversation by talking about the timeline on getting things started. It's going to be years before completion. From an actuarially standpoint, I'm dead. It's a fact.
No, that sounds terrible.
It's a fact. Because it's going to take that long. but the comprehensive plan will make projections for what will happen with the land mass. I did the design, rezoning, and all that went with 1,700 acres. That's where Stonecrest Mall is. That was done in 1974. I know you don't, I heard, we don't care. The point I wish you to listen to is that it's still within more than 1,000 acres of being developed. The answer to the question was asked is, it's market driven. We do know that over the period of time, the market will support what we're going to do. Why? Somewhat experience, I would say. But that's why we are phasing, and that's why we are approaching on a balance of the type of units that we're going to be opening up with and save the ecology. That's the only answer that I know to give. Yes, sir.
Are you telling us we're going to be looking at something like Stonecrest Mall?
Here, sir.
I'm sorry. Bill, are you saying
that? Right here. You got the mic.
I'm sorry. I thought you pointed to me. I'm sorry.
Good evening, gentlemen. Thank you for being here. My name is Marcelo Zapata. I've been living in East Roswell for the last 15 years with my family. And I've been paying attention to your presentation and all the great questions for my neighbors. And I came to realize that what is here is a big lack of solid data that supports not only your big assumption, but also the needs and wants of the community.
Yes.
So, just to give you an example, I'm going to the question right now, thank you. So, how many square feet of office space are currently available in Roswell, and what is the current occupancy rate? When we know that companies are encouraging employees when they are not traveling to work more from home. So you're talking about a lot of office space here. So what kind of data do you have to sustain your big assumption? Thank you.
We've done some market research, some data exploration to sustain what we are presenting for our zoning rezoning. We have not gone into the details, which will be done when we get into the construction specification. Remember, I said this at the beginning, as involves me. My job is to provide the basis for buildings that will go up. We think that that's depicted here is consistent with the UDC. We believe that it is consistent with the demonstrated needs that we've seen from the community. And that's the rationale in moving what we've done in this direction.
So summarizing,
no,
you don't have
ahead.
Solid data.
Go ahead. No, we have the next question. We have the next question.
Yeah, I want to summarize his answer.
All right, my name is Don Gordon, and I just want to read something from the 2030 Comprehensive Plan. And this is in regard to the Southeast Quadrant. The intent of this plan is the city intends for the Southeast Quadrant to achieve a walkable village feel. Any proposal for future development of the existing OCMS zoning would work to achieve the village intent by limiting any taller buildings and integrating them into the site using well-designed site layouts that mitigate the visual impact of heights by varying heights not to exceed 6 stories, using setbacks and locating them as indicated by the design principles below. So along Old Alabama and Holcomb Bridge, the intent is for low-scale feel, maximum 3 stories, with variation in height to create visual interest. A master plan mixed-use project with a catalyst project providing unique amenities and economic impact for the city may potentially be allowed to consider for taller buildings if appropriately integrated to the interior or rear of the project that is adjacent to Georgia 400, so as not to appear greater than 4 stories from Holcomb Bridge Road or any other public street. So my question to you is, we have the 2030 plan that city council approved and paid money to have developed. And I'm wondering why you have not taken this information and used that to develop this plan. Why isn't this good enough for you?
But taking the comprehensive plan recommendations, which we've talked about, it, like I said, it recommends three stories at Old Alabama Road. So let's just take that off the table, because we don't have, other than the townhomes, we don't actually have buildings right on Old Alabama Road. The buildings would be anywhere from 75 to a couple hundred feet from Old Alabama Road. So it also recommends buildings of six stories. Which we have, actually. We have a considerable amount of the development on, thank you.
Is that the 1986 study?
It's I'm actually addressing exactly what he read, which were the pages that I had referenced earlier. No, this is the most recent updated plan. He's looking at the right one. It also says that if you have, as you said, an ecological driven development, and it has it would have a large environmental impact, what they want you to do is, as I said, reduce the footprints of the buildings. So they would in turn recommend that you could go higher, and that as long as those taller buildings were near Old Alabama Road. So our eight-story building, thank you. The taller buildings would be along 400, and that's exactly where we put them. Now, as I said, the only building that is going to be taller than eight stories is the hotel. And the footprint of that hotel is actually considerably small. But it's right in the center, and it'll be right near where the other rest of the commercial area is. And did that address?
Why is it good enough for the developer? I think the gentleman was saying, you didn't answer that. Why is it good enough for the
developer?
I'm saying that we comply. So I don't know. I mean, we may disagree, but I think we're following the recommendations of the comprehensive plan.
Did you just say he had the right, he was reading from the right?
Yes, that's right.
And then I believe, I don't have it in front of me, but I think it was saying six stories with what it was supposed to be. So I believe
can you read that exception, please? Can you read the next sentence after the six-story recommendation?
Appropriately integrated to the interior or rear of the project that is adjacent to Jordan 400, so as not to appear greater than four stories from Holcomb Bridge or any other public street.
I can hear.
Please. All right. So I just read it.
Right.
Six stories is the maximum.
Right. But if properly integrated within the interior of the project next to 400. As long as it appear to be four stories from appear to be four stories from Holmes Bridge Road.
Or any other road.
Old Alabama Road. That was a 10-story hotel.
Okay, well, do you know how long the distance is? I'm trying to talk. Please, though. Do you have any idea what this is? What is this distance from Old Alabama Road to this eastward building, roughly?
400 feet.
It's 400 feet. So if I'm standing on Old Alabama Road, I've got a berm, I've got trees, I don't see any buildings for about 100 feet. Then 300 feet after that, there's an eight-story building in the distance next to 400. That is not going to be an eight-story building that's going to dominate Old Alabama Road. So I don't want to get into a one-on-one here.
Can you concede that what we want, why can't the developer see kind of what we want and at least consider that? The gentleman in blue laid out there, why can't that be at least a consideration? Maybe I'll come down the road with the Common Council, but can you see our point, Bill?
That is why we made considerable changes to the plan. A compromise of 200 apartments, that's not a compromise.
Please.
Yes, ma'am, I'm sorry.
Okay, for the record, Lisa's saying that I live in Marcus Lane. I like mixed use. I don't have a problem with mixed use. I do have a problem with size and volume of this mixed use, but
But I do like that you can work, play, have a good time. However, speaking to work, play, have a good time, you said that the first pieces that will go in are the apartments, the hotel, and the small retail space. Where am I supposed to work? Where am I supposed to work in phase one development? If there is no business coming in for me to work at, where am I supposed to work? I don't mind work, play being all together. Don't get me wrong. I like MARTA coming up. It means I can not sit on 400. I'm okay with lots of things. I know that we've got to enjoy our nature, enjoy our community, but we've got to think 30, 40 years ahead of time. I'm just asking you, in your first phase of development, where am I supposed to work? Because we all can't work at the grocery store, we all can't work at the nail salon, we all can't work at the hair salon, we all can't work at the boutique. Where am I supposed to work?
The first phase is controlled, as I said originally, primarily by the requirements of the governmental institutions to protect the water courses and the environment. The expansion of the first phase could be these office buildings or could swing down in this direction. We haven't come to that conclusion yet. But we know we've got to get everything done all around the lake. And that's the answer. And it's not something that is going to be put off for any length of time. It is market driven. One of the questions I saw floating around here is anybody being interested in the space? We've gotten some inquiries. We've gotten some inquiries about offices and office buildings. We're going to address that. But right now, it's preparing the land and getting the engineering design complete.
So you have interest already from businesses. You just can't tell us who those businesses are. So we're talking large corporations, or we're talking
we're talking, well.
I'm just asking, if like small little lawyer, CA firm, or
North
Side Hospital. Let's just say some of the above.
Okay, so if you've got big and little interested in this property.
Yes.
Okay, that's what we need to know. We need to know that there are businesses that are asking you about your property. It's a whole lot of work, a whole lot of their buy-in, and I know there might be some
place to
work,
because
hearing
your
numbers.
There's a question on that.
Hi, I'm Tiella. I am not privy to most meetings like this, but I'm wondering if council members normally do not attend. I'm getting the feeling that they really do not care.
Website that you can go to for details about the information. Thank you for coming.
The video will be on YouTube. The video will be on YouTube. I have the red book. If you'd like a copy, you can go wherever you want. Right. Help yourself to the red book.
You run it, but then you're in the, and so what, I'm glad I didn't say what I
No, that's all right.
Let me look at a detailed plan. I may have it.
Okay, thank you.
All right, I got my swap.
Thank you. Sorry about that.
Prior to the location,